10:36, need to know with Jeff Angelo, News Radio 1040 WHO, Monday, February 19th. This is a follow-up interview. This is an interview that I did an interview a couple of weeks ago with Seth Denton, and we were talking about health insurance. And Seth said, look, I could get into what's driving up healthcare costs in this country, but that's a whole another interview. And you all enjoyed hearing from Seth so much. I got a lot of contact after that interview. To say, well, would you bring him back on so he could talk about it? So this is Seth Denton, the sequel. Seth Denton 2, Electric Boogaloo. Seth Denton on Lippman Law Newsmaker Line. How are you, Seth? Good to talk to you.
I don't know about that introduction, but thanks for having me back on. I appreciate round two of this.
Well, you had made a reference. People were really enjoying the conversation that you and I were having the last time you and I talked, and we were talking about health insurance, and you made that reference. You said, let's talk about what's driving up healthcare costs, and people said, I would really like to hear Seth talk about that, so I appreciate having you back on. And so Seth, when you look at this particular situation, and you're exactly right to put this in the bigger perspective that a lot of us are talking about health insurance because we're worried we're going to get really sick and not be able to afford the treatment. What's the issue in this country in your mind as far as why healthcare costs are on the rise?
You know, Jeff, there's a number of things that are causing healthcare itself to go up. And again, I think I mentioned this the first time we talked. Health insurance is just a derivative of healthcare costs, right? Health insurance
right.
is the financing of healthcare. So while there are literally dozens of things, and we can talk about some of them today, the primary driver of increasing costs in the healthcare system is a lack of transparency within the healthcare system. For example, you know, healthcare is that one thing in the world, or specifically here in the United States, that I can go get a service rendered to me without ever knowing what the real cost of that service is until after it's been performed.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And
yeah.
So, and from a legal standpoint, providers and facilities are brilliant about having you sign a multiple-page terms and conditions waiver prior to rendering those services to you, effectively assuming the liability for whatever they're willing to bill. And so, you know, if we think about all of the other aspects of those things that we consume, goods and services, very rarely do we find something that is to the extent of healthcare from an expense ratio that we're willing to engage in before we know what we're going to be spending. And the system is set up to make sure that we really don't know and don't have the resources available to us on the front end to understand what our expenses are going to be prior to them being rendered.
Well, and Seth, here's what drives me crazy about that. For example, you know, we do have a sector of the healthcare industry that's outside of all of this, LASIK eye surgery. I can walk into a LASIK place right now and get an estimate on what it would cost for me to get these services. I could go to another one, say, well, what's it going to cost me? And I can compare, and, you know, there'll be reviews online. And so we've got an example of how that would work, but most of our healthcare system doesn't work like that. It drives me crazy.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. And what we find is in those elective areas of healthcare, and so, you know, dentistry and LASIK you mentioned, and even, you know, certain reconstruction or plastic surgeries, because those are elective, you know, there is a process by which we get a predetermination of benefit, and we understand what we're going to be spending versus, you know, what we're going to be getting. However, you know, when you put a life issue on the table,
mm-hmm.
right, I don't have the ability oftentimes, if I'm in the ambulance, to understand what I'm about to get before I've gotten it,
right?
You're not taking the time to really ask me, hey, do you want this, you know, want us to operate on you? You know, you're about to die. Right.
Right.
So this is the problem with this, and the system understands this. And understand, I am not in favor of government regulation in a lot of areas. However, healthcare is one of those areas that I do think the government needs to step in and require some systematic, we'll call them bills of rights of patients as they're accessing the system to really understand what's going on before I have to be stuck with a bill.
And certainly politicians, Seth, are searching for that answer. President Trump released a white paper talking about how he would try to get prescription costs under control. And again, instinctively, I'm thinking, okay, it seems like government involvement is part of the problem and the answer is more government involvement? Or is there a role in all of this that the government can reasonably play to try to get some to get our arms around some of the costs of, say, something like prescription drugs?
Yeah, I'm glad you brought up the white paper that was released. There were a couple things on the white paper, and I read it. I've read it a number of times, actually. One of the main things that I was disappointed about within the white paper was that they released it on a Friday. And Jeff, as you well know, if you want something to go under the radar,
it's Friday news dump day.
On a Friday, right?
Yeah.
And after reading it, I think the reason that they did that is it was really short on substance from a solution standpoint. Listen, this is something that everybody's struggling with, and for conservatives, we typically don't like the idea of the government getting involved in something. But I think there is some areas where the government can set some regulatory boundaries here. And I've mentioned a couple of them. And I encourage your listeners to go to our website, gdpadvisors.com. And,
sure.
And in our blog, we've listed out a number of solutions that we would recommend. Matter of fact, we're releasing a book that I penned. It's called The Cure, A Blueprint for Solving America's Healthcare Crisis. Now, I'll be in advance of saying that there's some things in there that conservatives aren't going to like. But there's plenty in there that liberals won't like either.
Right.
But the problem is that with health care, this is a nonpartisan issue, and it needs to have nonpartisan solutions to solve them. So a couple of them are, and I'll mention another one real quick, and we're seeing this a lot in Texas, but even throughout the country, is patients will go to a hospital that's in-network but be seen by physicians and providers that are out-of-network.
Mm-hmm.
Right?
Right.
And so they have no idea this is going on. Until long after they get out of the hospital and start receiving these bills saying, hey, you owe us this money, because, yes, the hospital was in network, but the physician wasn't. I mean, that is one area that I think we could probably all agree that the government should step in and say, that's an unfair business practice.
Right.
Right? And so there are some areas I think that the government can establish some regulation without being too intrusive into the capitalism society that we live in. But we've got to protect the patient's bill of rights and understanding if I go get services rendered, I should have an idea of what they're going to cost me prior to being done. And in the absence of that, I shouldn't be balance billed for out-of-network services.
Well, you brought this up, Seth, when you're talking about the capitalist model, which works over and over again in so many different areas. It's all about empowering me as the consumer. And in healthcare, I can get it. Like you just gave a great example. A person comes out of the hospital. Now they're getting billed. Oh, I saw an out-of-network doctor. They had no idea. And so as a consumer, I don't feel empowered at all in our healthcare system.
You know, you're right. And unfortunately, that's on us as consumers in some ways, right?
I mean,
the average American spends twice the amount of time researching a television that they're going to purchase before than they do researching their doctor or the prescription in which the doctor prescribes, right? That's on us. We need to do a better job of asking questions and understanding and researching. There are tools out there for a consumer to be able to do some research ahead of time when that's available to them, right? We understand that in emergency situations, we can't do that. But I always encourage our clients and the employees of our clients to go out and make sure they understand where to access care and where the most effective outcomes are and those types of things. Because, you know, we continue to look to the federal government to solve the healthcare crisis in the United States. And one of the statements I've made a number of times is we must stop looking at healthcare for the federal government to create a macro solution.
Yeah.
We need to be the micro solution ourselves and start being better consumers and better understanders and demand more of the healthcare industry that is providing us these goods and services.
This is healthcare expert Seth Denton at 15 minutes before 11 o'clock, News Radio 1040 WHO. Seth, what role does insurance, if any, have to play in driving down healthcare costs? And here's the reason I'm asking you that question. It's long been touted by a lot of legislators that we be allowed to purchase insurance across state lines, that we allow to be able to form groups across the nation to purchase insurance as a group. Does that have any impact at all, getting healthcare insurance costs under control, on healthcare costs, or are those two separate and distinct issues?
No, they are very much related because, again, most Americans, all but about 2%, are accessing the healthcare market through health insurance, right? And that's where we understand where to go and what we're going to spend and all of that. However, to your point, it is absolutely imperative, and one of those things that we suggest in our book is that both the state barriers be removed, but also employers' ability, because most Americans get health insurance through the employer market, right? And
right.
So employers should be able to come together, and by the way, they can, and we do this with our clients, is the employers can come together and share risk. That's all insurance is, right? If insurance is a finance company, insurance, the structure of it is the long-term game, is to take large cumulative expenses and spread them out over numbers of people over numbers of years. And so, again, if I'm a business owner and I'm providing insurance to my employees, when you and I last talked, we were talking about Berkshire Hathaway and J.P. Morgan and yep. Amazon coming together. They're coming together as three separate employers to share risk, right? And this is doable now in the marketplace. But employers need to ask better questions when they're reviewing their insurance options. So I think if you're looking to the Anthems, Blue Crosses, at United, Cignas, and Aetnas to step up and solve this problem, you're looking in the wrong spot, because if you look at their stock prices, they're doing quite well under the current model. So I don't think they're going to step out of that box and try to get more innovative. We've got to do a better job of understanding how we buy things. And then I would hope that some regulations drop from a state-based related issue of allowing insurers to go across state lines and become more competitive.
Seth, I got a text on the text line that it goes to the heart of what you were just talking about what is the responsibility of the consumer versus the hospital or someone else. This texter said, Jeff, in our hospital, 75% of the patient charges were determined by a fee schedule from the third-party payer. That's not a problem with hospital transparency. Anyone who asked was given the list charge of a procedure. So you were talking about that it's sometimes we kind of look toward everybody else to solve this problem. Sometimes the consumer needs to be aware.
Absolutely. You know, and again, I mentioned it just a second ago when I talked about and I gave the analogy of the television purchase versus the doctor purchase.
Yeah.
Right? We've got to do a better job of being a better consumer and asking better questions. Matter of fact, Health and Human Services put out a commercial a couple of years ago of a person asking a dozen questions before they bought a product. I can't remember if it was a car or something. And then they fast forward to them in their doctor's office and they say, do you have any questions? They went, nope.
Nope.
Right? I mean, so that's the first thing is we've got to ask better questions. The second thing is, as far as your texter comment, I think the fee-for-service model is part of what's broken with the healthcare system in general too, right?
Yep.
Is that, you know, if I go in, I should have a test run on me if it's because the providers think that it's the test that needs to be run to determine the outcome of what they need to do, not, hey, if we run this test, it's going to generate X amount of dollars for the hospital systems, right?
Mm-hmm.
And so, again, we all have to be in this world together. I need the hospital systems. I need the provider systems. I need the insurance systems. But we've got to get to a place where we can all come together and understand that profit is a good thing, but I need to understand that if they are making a profit, I'm okay with that based on these variables, just like I do with anything else that I consume.
Well, and getting political for a moment, Seth, I think part of the push toward a government-run healthcare system is that there are politicians and activists that believe it's immoral for people to be making money off of healthcare. I've stated that, and I don't mean that. I don't mean that as some kind of cynical swipe. I think there are people who legitimately believe that.
You know, and they do. What I would infuse here, though, is what happens to innovation if there isn't an opportunity to generate profit, right?
Mm-hmm.
I mean, if we look at the rest of the world that is on some type of government-run, systematic healthcare platform, they look to the United States for innovation. They look to the United States for solving problems when it comes to healthcare or medications or things like that. Why? Because our capitalistic society rewards innovation and rewards those that are willing to step up. So I think if you strip out that ability for companies to make a profit off of the healthcare innovation structure, then you're stripping away the ability for new innovations and new treatments to come out that can start to make our health better throughout the United States and the world.
So, Seth, what is the website and what is the upcoming book? I know people are going to come out of this interview wanting more information.
Sure. Yeah, GDPAdvisors.com is the website. The book is entitled The Cure, A Blueprint for Solving America's Healthcare Crisis. And we hope to have that released here in the next 60 to 90 days.
All right. His name is Seth Denton. Seth, always a pleasure. I'm sure we'll talk again soon.
Jeff, thanks for having me on again.